So I'm in the interesting position of actually introducing myself. I was sent an email just a few minutes ago saying that the New America Foundation didn't have anyone on hand to introduce the panel, and so they asked if I would be willing to do it. And I said, of course, because I will have a nice extensive discussion of all the many virtues of the next panelist sitting over here, Jacob Hacker. Yeah, how are you, Jacob? I'm really pleased to be here, and the New America Foundation, I guess, can be forgiven for not having someone to introduce me, because they've done so much for me over the years. We had the launch event for the Economic Security Index here roughly a year ago, back in the summer of 2010, and then we also had a follow-up event looking at public opinion during the Great Recession, which was also a great event. And so today we're going to be doing a second installment of the Economic Security Index project. I want to just mention a couple sponsors for this event. In addition to the Rockefeller Foundation that has funded this work and the New America Foundation that has helped us launch it here, I'm very grateful to the fact that the foundation created an independent advisory council to advise our work, one of whose members, Larry Michel, is with us today. The other members of the advisory group are Henry Aaron of the Brookings Institution, Gary Burtless of the Brookings Institution, Hank Farber of Princeton University, Alicia Munnell of Boston College, and Robert Solow, who needs no affiliation since he was the Nobel Prize winner in economics in 1987. I want to thank EJ, who actually also is here for the initial event. EJ has been a friend and a provider of wonderful blurbs for things I've written for a long time. Since I was a research fellow at the Brookings Institution, alongside him, I had an alcove. Well, actually, it was called an office, but it had no door, that was right across from EJ. And I'll just say that I did a lot less work on my dissertation and drank a lot more red wine than I would have otherwise. But it was definitely worth it in terms of my long-term intellectual development. I also want to thank my team. Some of whom are listed here. In addition, and we have Austin is here today, right in the front row, and Stuart Craig back there. In addition, Greg Huber, Mark Schlesinger, and Philip Rehm were partners in this work and weren't able to be here today. I'll stop with the thanks, because I want to try to get through the results pretty quickly so that we can have a good discussion. We have a really fine panel. I won't actually introduce the panel. I'll let EJ do that. But I'm really pleased to have all these folks here today. And whenever I'm under time constraints, I think of an evaluation I received when I was a new assistant professor at Yale. It began very promisingly. It said, "Professor Hacker, if I had just 15 minutes to live, I'd want to spend it in your class, because that way it would seem like an hour." So I forgive I have to apologize to Austin for having repeated that joke, and to EJ as well, but he still laughs. So we know that even before the economic downturn, that many Americans were concerned about their economic security. This was a poll that the Rockefeller Foundation did in 2007. It was part of a worker security initiative they began, and which funded the Economic Security Index project. And it also was important because when we were doing our own polling work 2 years later, we built on some of the questions in this survey. So we were able to look at changes in people's perceptions of economic security between 2007 and 2009. And I'm going to refer to some of those polling results in what follows, but the measure of economic security I'm going to discuss is actually based not on public opinion polls, but on economic data that looks at changes in Americans' economic circumstances from year to year. So the first question, and the obvious one, is what are we talking about when we talk about economic security? And basically, the definition that we came up with as we were developing the index was very straightforward, that there were two basic components to economic security. One was exposure to risk, and the other was the degree of protection that one had against economic loss. So in other words, economic security is basically whether people are vulnerable to major risks to their economic well-being. Now, there's clearly, as I just noted, a psychological component to economic security, which is why we did our public opinion survey. But in designing the Economic Security Index, following on on the basic approach to looking at, say, poverty or unemployment or median incomes, we wanted to have a measure that was based on economic data that showed how people's economic circumstances changed over time. Now, that dynamic aspect of economic security is the hardest to capture for two reasons. One is that it's very hard, as I'll note in a moment, to find good data that looks at how people's economic circumstances change from year to year or over longer periods. The second reason why I think this definition raises questions or issues is that clearly economic security is more or different than income volatility. It really concerns risks of downward economic loss. And that's really to the extent that we're incorporating a core psychological element into our definition of economic security, it's that we're putting primacy in understanding economic security on people's aversion to loss. As behavioral economists have called this phenomenon, it is people are highly loss averse. They fear losing what they have. And even Americans feel this way. Back in 2005, during the one of the battleground surveys that was done in the run-up to the 2006 midterm election, asked people whether they'd prefer to have stable, secure incomes or the opportunity to make more money. These are Americans, after all, and this is in the midst of the 2000s expansion. You would have thought, I think, that most Americans would say the opportunity to make more money. Surprisingly, by a 2-to-1 margin, they said they preferred income security. And I think this is just a measure of how strong this loss aversion preference is. So in thinking about economic security, we put heavy emphasis on the downward risk of economic loss. That still raises a lot of questions about how one would actually measure economic loss. Are we looking at wealth or income or some other measure of economic well-being? We decided, after much consideration and looking at what the available sources, to focus on a special measure of income. And this actually is not so far from the measure of income that is now being used by the Census Bureau in developing its poverty line. We call it available household income. It's basically income from all sources, including government benefits, less out-of-pocket medical costs, and the cost of servicing one's financial debts. When one has negative financial net worth. So we say that if this measure of available income, again, household income from all sources minus medical spending minus debt service, that when this changes, drops from one year to the next by 25% or more, that this household is counted as, this individual is counted as insecure. We adjust, of course, for inflation. We also adjust for household size. And finally, we make a special exception, if you will, for two groups. You are not counted as insecure under this definition, even if you experience a 25% loss, if you are either entering retirement, which turns out to be a trivial exclusion, and second of all, or if, second, you have enough financial wealth to be able to buffer, to be able to basically pay the difference between your former income and your current income until you recover back to your prior income level. So in other words, if you have enough precautionary savings that you're able to basically draw down your savings so that you don't experience a loss in your available resources, then you're not counted as insecure. And I'll get to how we actually measure those things in a moment. So that means that our measure was really based on three key elements of economic security. First, the year-to-year income fluctuations, and in particular, year-to-year income drops. Your year-to-year changes in out-of-pocket medical spending, and then whether or not you have an adequate financial safety net. And just to give you a sense of what this means, I'll say two quick things, because they'll become salient when we start to look at the actual results. First, if you, let's say, have $50,000 in available household income, it would mean your income would have to drop to $37,500 or lower for you to be counted as insecure if you didn't have, unless you had enough savings to pay for that difference until a typical person like you recovered. But one important thing to note is this is every year. So let's say it's from year to year. So it's an annual measure. So it's from, say, 2009 to 2010. Then you would have to experience, if you were going to be counted as insecure the next year, you would also have to experience another drop in income of 25% or greater from your new base income to be counted as insecure. So you might think that's a very stringent test, and indeed it is. But if you think about it, what this is really is, in some sense, is a measure of the of income risks that families are facing, right? The share of the population or of a defined group, say the age, that experience this loss is basically a measure of the chance that someone like this will experience a drop of this. And that, in that sense, when it goes up, it indicates that more Americans are insecure. And I'll come back to this in the conclusion. Why do we choose these three elements? Well, I've already noted that that this is very close to how the Census Bureau is now conceptualizing poverty. That is to say that medical care is a constraint on available income and debt service is a constraint on available income. And at the same time, I've mentioned that people who have large financial wealth holdings are able to basically self-insure against large income losses. But let me just say a word about why income is the metric that we use. It's not only that it's one that's well measured, it also turns out that large income losses are among the most salient risks to individuals. So we did the survey in 2009, and in March we asked people to basically rank from 1 to 7, 1 being a highly anticipatable, easy to deal with risk, and 7 being a risk that's very hard to anticipate and prepare for. And noticeably, the ones that are very high on the scale are not retiring poor, which people seem to think you can plan against, or housing affordability, but losing health insurance, a job, being disabled, or having big medical costs. And those are all core components of the economic security index as we developed it. We also, as I said, have the standard of 25%. And while this also it has a nice intuitive feel, we also were pleased to find when we did our survey that it fit very closely with people's own self-assessed capacity to deal with large drops in income. We asked people how long they could go before without their current income before hardship sets in. Unfortunately, we designed the survey before we knew that we were interested in doing a 25% standard. But one thing, what we can say is if you look at this, that 3 months is probably about the median. 64% said 4 months or less. And that means that for a typical household or individual, a 25% threshold is probably a pretty close to the amount of income loss, that is 3 months of income, that would induce hardship. Now, I just want to emphasize one thing before moving on, is that our measure of whether you have adequate financial wealth is based on financial wealth, not housing wealth. And our main reason for not including housing wealth or debt in our measure is that housing is a pretty difficult asset to liquidate when you face major income losses. Certainly, in recent years, it's been a difficult asset in general. But our idea is that when someone loses a job or is disabled, their housing is not likely to be a very big source of security. They need to have a place to live after all. When the economy is down or when they're out of work, it may be difficult for them to use their home as a source of cash. And in any case, we did some analyses to look at how sensitive our measure is to our treatment of housing, and we found that it basically lowers the index a bit prior to recent years, but of course in recent years with the housing market down, it's much less of a buffer against economic insecurity. So how do we calculate economic security? Well, in the last report that I presented last year, we used the Survey of Income and Program Participation. The Survey of Income and Program Participation is a large panel survey done by the Census Bureau. A panel survey is a survey that follows individuals over time. Most surveys are not panel surveys. Most surveys are one-shot, random samples of the population. This is a panel survey basically interviews someone 1 year or 1 month and then interviews them the next year or the next month over time for some period of time. The longest panel survey, the Panel Study of Income Dynamics, has done this for about 40 years. The Survey of Income and Program Participation uses these mini panels from the early 1980s on, where it surveys people for a period of 3 to 5 years, 2 to 4 years, Austin's nodding, 2 to 4 years. And in our initial analysis, we used the Survey of Income and Program Participation, the SIP, but we decided against it for this report and actually moved to another approach that better captures the developments in recent years. So I want to explain that report and its motives. So basically now, rather than using the Survey of Income and Program Participation, we went to the sort of mother load for income and demographic data, namely the Census Bureau's March Current Population Survey. This is a survey that is used for all of the major reports about health insurance and poverty that you read every year. It is not technically a panel survey. It is basically a survey of geographic residences, but it turns out that you can actually that reaches different people every year. But it turns out that because of the structure of the survey, you can actually use it as a panel survey for one year to the next by looking at people who have not moved from 1 year to the next in March of each year. So we're basically linking data from March to March, and the advantages of this over the SIP are several fold. First of all, the SIP, as I mentioned, is not a continuous panel survey. It's a series of short-term panels, and there was no panel survey in the field during the onset of the Great Recession. So basically, we have no data on income loss from the SIP from roughly 2007 to 2000 through 2009. Second of all, the March CPS is not only this gold standard that's used for other analyses, but also a very large survey that, with proper weighting, can be used for state analyses. And so being able to do state-by-state comparison was a big advantage. Third, and this is getting kind of technical, but what we discovered with the Survey of Income and Program Participation is that it has a very high attrition rate, and a relatively high attrition rate. And as a result, we're concerned that toward the end of each of these panels, 3 or 4 year panels, you were actually getting biased results because a lot of people were dropping out of the survey. That's not a problem with the March CPS. Basically, we have, in each case, a 2 year panel from 1 year to the next, and the attrition rate and the like does not change much over time. So that's not an issue. The main drawback of this approach is that the March CPS only allows us to look at geographic units rather than individuals, which means that we cannot look at people who have moved. So Austin actually has done some analyses using the Survey of Income and Program Participation to see how much of a bias this might introduce. And it is the case that people who move experience higher income instability than those who do not, but they are a relatively small portion of the overall sample. And in fact, migration has been declining in the United States, contrary to many people's belief, over this period from the 1980s until last few years. It falls over this period. And our own estimates suggest that this has only a very small bias. And remember that since people who move have higher volatility, it's a bias that basically reduces the level of insecurity that we find. Okay, so we have I'll show you the results in a moment, but those are the motives for the shift, and we're very confident that our new approach, which we'll be using going forward, is both an advance over the previous approach and will provide a much more detailed data, not just for the most recent period, as I'll show you, but also we can actually go back before the mid-1980s using this data to look at income trends from basically the late 1960s on. And that's one of the next steps we're going to be taking. Okay. We, at the same time, have a constraint that we had before. There's not good medical expenditure data in either the CPS or in our previous survey, Survey of Income and Program Participation. So we basically developed an imputation method that is very advanced and quite good at predicting out-of-pocket medical spending, and not just in 1 year, but from 1 year to the next. And I'm happy to talk about that for the aficionados more. And then finally, we bring in wealth data from the Survey of Income and Program Participation, and our benchmarking has shown that again is a very reliable way of predicting wealth levels. Remember, we're not focusing on wealth changes. This is just the wealth level. So basically, whether you have debt or whether you have enough financial wealth to be counted as secure. So we're less concerned So the imputation procedure does not have to predict changes in wealth from one year to the next, which is a good thing because it turns out that there really aren't very good sources on wealth dynamics. Finally, I mentioned that the amount of wealth that you need is based on how long it takes for you to recover. You might be thinking, well, how would you know that given that the CPS is just a two-year panel? And for most people, they don't just immediately bounce back. Obviously, if you drop to 25% in the second year, we don't know what happens to you after that. So what we did is we used a panel study of income dynamics, which, as I mentioned, is available for 40 years to estimate the long-term recovery of income. Just to illustrate those results, because I think this is actually one of the cooler things that we're able to do, you can get a sense of what the dynamics of income loss are in this figure. Basically, we're looking at three different sizes of drops. So in the first year, of course, in the year before the drop, you have 100% of your pre-dropped income, and then you drop down. So this is a small drop, 25 to 35%, small by our standards. Here you see a 35 to 50% drop, and then here's the really big drop, half income or more, and you can see that recovery is quite slow, though you recover in roughly the same period of time. To be clear, these are just illustrative. These are just the observed patterns in the panel study of income dynamics. There are a bunch of statistical reasons why we don't use these exact numbers. We use a hazard model that allows us to predict how long it takes for people to recover, and then from that calculate how much of their income they would need. Just to be clear, you'll see in a moment that the exclusion of people based on wealth has a fairly small effect in general, and therefore, you know, changing these estimates modestly would have very little effect. Okay, lots of buildup. Let's actually see what's happened to economic security. Now, I don't want to keep you in suspense. I'm sure that given the previous report, given what we know about the economy, that you probably know where this is going. Here are the downturns. You can see that the most recent downturn was quite prolonged relative to both the 1991 and 2001 recessions. So you can see here both that it's a very cyclical trend, a very cyclical pattern, with downturns producing an uptick in insecurity, and that there's a quite striking rise in the most recent downturn. I think there are two things to note here. First, the first is just how sustained economic insecurity has been most during this recent downturn. For each of the last 3 years, every year, more than 20% of Americans have experienced a 25% or greater drop in available household income without an adequate financial safety net. The other thing to note is that this is a long-term trend as well, and this is true even if you take out the most recent years. It looks as if with each downturn, the recovery is back to a slightly higher normal plateau than the previous one. I'll return to this theme in thinking about what where we might be going. It should also be said that we've done some analyses with the panel study of income dynamics, and we'll be doing analyses with this current population survey to look at previous years. And there's nothing that we've done or other scholars have done suggests that the mid-1980s was somehow a low point in economic security, a high point in economic insecurity. In fact, most of these measures of income volatility show a rise over the 1970s and early 1980s as well. So this was not an artificially low point. So based on our measure, I can show you what I mentioned earlier, that the contribution of the different elements of the index. So the most important factor, given how we constructed the index, is these year-to-year declines of 25% of income or more. And you can see that basically follows the pattern of the rest of the index. If you add in medical costs, you can see a slight increase in the overall trend. Now, that slight increase, as I'll show you in a moment, is a lot smaller than the increase in out-of-pocket medical costs over this period. At the median, out-of-pocket medical costs increased about 36% over this period, which is a very large increase. But the point is that to count as insecure in our measure, that your out-of-pocket medical costs have to push you over this 25% loss threshold. They have to change from 1 year to the next. So a lot of that increase in out-of-pocket medical costs is probably represented by people who have stably high spending rather than fluctuations in spending. Now add in debt. You can see that debt really doesn't do much for the index until you get to the most recent years, and I'll show you why, although you already know the answer. And then finally, if we take into account wealth, you can see that it generally brings the index back down to somewhere between
the income and medical cost measure, the yellow line, and the income only, but it gets a little bit closer over time to the income and medical cost measure, which is suggestive that the wealth buffers in particular are less of important in offsetting income loss in the most recent years. So the financial wealth holdings, the buffers, are crucial for looking at this this yellow line here, white line here. And you can see now on this figure why it is that the last few years have really shown a separation of the income and medical costs and the income, medical costs, and debt lines. At the median, household financial wealth, that is non-housing wealth and liabilities added up, your net financial wealth, has been zero. So there's been no, and there's only a slight, as you can see in the mid-90s, there's a slight move above zero, but it's very small. At the 25th percentile, you can see that it's been that debt has increased, and at the 10th percentile of wealth holdings, it's plummeted. That's about a $10,000 a household increase in net debt between 2004 and 2010. On medical care, just to substantiate the story I told you, there has been a pretty big increase for the non-elderly, and you'll see in a moment why I have to have these axes so high, 80%. For the aged, you can see they spend massively more. There are two things to note here. One is that the median and among higher income citizens, especially in the last few years, there has been a fairly dramatic increase. This may not look that large, but it's basically a doubling of the share of Americans 18 to 64 who spend more than 10% of their income on medical costs out of pocket. But at the lowest income levels, among both the aged who have been assisted by the Medicare prescription drug benefit and the expansion of coverage for dual eligibles, and among the non-elderly who've been assisted by the expansion of Medicaid and SCHIP, medical out-of-pocket expenditures as a share of income have actually stabilized. I want to make one very important point here. There are two ways to interpret this. One is that we've done a great job protecting low-income Americans against rising medical costs. The other is that we might not be doing that great of a job because we don't know whether or not this stable spending as a share of income is a reflection of better policies protecting these citizens. It surely partly is, or whether or not it reflects, and to what degree it reflects, the fact that people are putting off medical care or receiving care that's not paid for in the form of charity care. And that's one of the problems with our measure, is that medical out-of-pocket expenditures, which is, I think, the best possible measure, but not the only possible measure, doesn't allow you to distinguish between spending low spending for those reasons. Low spending could either reflect lack of care, or low spending could reflect good insurance. Okay, so the last slide I want to show you before concluding is an illustration of the demographic differences we find. We go through a whole host of them: race, education, age, and education, race, education, age, household type. I want to show you age because I think it helps us see the role of medical costs, and second of all, it's telling, I think, given who's borne the brunt of this recession. So first, I'll put up the results. Sadly, I have to put them up one by one for the ESI without medical expenditures. So this is each age group here, and then by period, 1985 to 95, 97 to 2007, and then the Great Recession period. You can see a pretty clear pattern going up across each of these groups. Note, though, that for older Americans, these two periods do not look particularly distinct. For younger Americans, they look much more distinct. That is, the long-term trend towards increased insecurity seems much more dramatic for younger Americans. When you add in medical costs, what you see is that for older Americans, they look much less secure. And this is what we found with the Census Bureau data as well, with poverty, that medical costs are a much bigger bite older Americans' incomes. And so in this respect, the other thing I would note is that despite a lot of talk about how only the young have borne the brunt of this downturn, it actually looks as if there's been a very big increase in income instability for older Americans as well. This may reflect in part the fact that older Americans are much more likely to be in the labor force than they were a generation ago. Okay, so
But I'd say we're talking about almost 23% of 18 to 34-year-olds experiencing a quarter or more drop in income from 1 year to the next in the most recent downturn every year. It's a pretty dramatic number. So this is not the end of the fun reports that we'll be providing over the next few years. And we're also going to be providing, based on this new CPS approach, state-by-state results soon. We have commissioned, we're in the process of commissioning a new survey. And as you've seen, the first survey has produced a lot of interesting findings about people's views of economic security. One thing that I will mention that I think is quite crucial as we think about where we're going is that is two things. Actually, first of all, we were at the OECD, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. Austin and Philip were there with me, and we presented some cross-national results. I won't be giving away too much in saying that the United States looks less secure, at least in the run-up to this recent downturn, than do other countries. It will be interesting to look at those findings going forward as the euro crisis has effects on European economies. But at least on our first glance, the higher levels of inequality in the United States are matched by higher levels of insecurity and income instability as well. The one thing I wanted to mention was this role of government policy. Remember, this is taking place against the backdrop of a fairly substantial expansion of unemployment insurance and very aggressive efforts to try to help the economy starting in 2009. And in thinking about going forward, I think there are two contrasting trends. And for those who want to look at the results more fully, they should go to this website. On the one hand, our measure is a measure of income loss, of income instability. So if families or or individuals lose a job and they're basically stuck at a low income, they're not treated as unstable, right, and insecure. So it's really very sensitive to increases, say, in the unemployment rate or increases in the fluctuation of healthcare costs, not so much by the baseline level of unemployment or healthcare spending. That said, it does look like it captures the recession pretty well. However, those levels, which are above 20% in recent years, are against the backdrop of this major expansion of government aid. And it's not clear to me which of the two effects that we should see going forward will dominate. On the one hand, if we continue to see very slow growth, but the unemployment rate kind of creeps back down, and we don't have a lot of new people entering the category of the job list, we should expect this rate to go down. On the other hand, the expiring of a lot of these measures could very well lead to an increase, at least among some populations, of insecurity. Think of the 2 million people who are facing the cutoff of unemployment benefits if unemployment insurance is not extended. I think what we can say safely now, since forecasting the future is always difficult, since it hasn't happened yet, what we can safely say now is that America's economic security is under challenge as more than at any point in the last quarter century.
So since Jacob couldn't introduce himself fully, I just want to say that he's absolutely right. He spent 9 months outside my office, right outside my office, and I have been learning from Jacob ever since. In fact, I saw Kurt Ganz is in the audience, so he actually will remember this from G. McCarthy's campaign. There were little buttons that said for McCarthy before New Hampshire after he did well in the New Hampshire primary. I was for Hacker before he was famous, and because he spent those 9 months outside my office, I've claimed credit for all the brilliant things he has done ever since. Personal credit. The other point I would like to make is that social justice needs warm-hearted friends, but it also needs hard-headed friends. And while I can testify that Jacob is warm-hearted, as you could see from those wonderful charts, I love the way things are moved around, although my conclusion is we will entirely get rid of economic insecurity when people lose all their income by the time this is over, and then there's no place to drop from. But it needs hard-headed friends, and I think what Jacob and his colleagues have done here is exceptionally useful. people, because unemployment is an important measure, but it's an imperfect measure. Even income growth is an imperfect measure, partly because it depends on how broadly shared the income growth is. And I think economic insecurity is a genuinely helpful measure of the problems we face, and if Jacob and his colleagues keep working hard, eventually of the progress we've made. So keep at us, Jacob. This is an exceptional panel, and I will introduce them in the order in which they have agreed to speak. The Larry's biography that I have here says Larry is a nationally recognized economist. That's true, but not recognized enough for my taste. He deserves even more than he already has. He's president of the Economic Policy Institute. He's been president there since 2002. He first joined EPI as a research director. He's done a lot of different kinds of work, but one of the many great things he's done is he's co-authored the 11 editions of The State of Working America, which former Labor Secretary Bob Reich said, and I agree with him, remains unrivaled as the most trusted source for a comprehensive understanding of how working Americans and their families are faring in the economy. Larry had a fellowship at the U.S. Department of Labor. No, I want you to be nationally recognized even more. He was a faculty member at Cornell. And I like this fact in his bio. His PhD in economics is from the University of Wisconsin, which is, for many generations has provided our nation with learned progressives. So thank you to the University of Wisconsin. John Cohn is senior editor at the New Republic. His blog is essential reading. His writing on healthcare is essential. I always told people if they wanted to understand everything that was happening on the healthcare bill, just read Jonathan Cohn and Ezra Klein. I was extremely well informed as a result of that. I can also, he is a senior fellow at Demos. He's a contributing editor at the American Prospect. And you must have been about 18 years old the first time you edited me. And I can say, when I wrote a piece for the Prospect, and I can say that it's not surprising that Jonathan is such a good writer because he is a superb editor. He's received lots of awards for his writing. And in addition to doing the best coverage of the healthcare law, he also wrote one of the best books about the healthcare system. And Matt Iglesias is Slate Magazine's business and economics correspondent. He is also essential reading. Before joining the magazine, he worked for Think Progress, The Atlantic, TPM Media, and The American Prospect. He is the author of Heads in the Sand, published in 2008, and his next book comes out, and I can't wait to read it, in March of 2012. Its title is The Rent is Too Damn High. So we all look forward to that. I'm going to, each of our respondents will speak for about 5 minutes. I'll go sit down during that. I will ask a few questions, but I want to bring the audience in as quickly as possible, and I will do that. So first, Larry Michel.
Thank you, EJ, and thank you, Jacob, for inviting me and being on this panel with these great young pundits. So, I don't know, what should I do first? You know, this is great work. I look forward to incorporating it in the next State of Working America. I'm sure there'll be at least one table and one graph reflecting these data. It is a little surprising it didn't increase more in the downturn. One of the things one of my disappointments about the presentation is that it's hard to get the actual numbers from the book itself. But luckily, there's a website where I can go get the actual data. But you know, as Jacob pointed out in the last report, and again, there's been a secular increase in economic insecurity over time. And if you look at the data for 2006 and 7 by the graph and how much it went up by 2008, 9, and 10, it doesn't really jump up as much as my priors would suggest it would. And perhaps that's, you know, we have such a great welfare state, but perhaps it's something else. I don't know. The reason why I think it's surprising is that I frequently emphasize how extensive the impact of unemployment is. 9% unemployment does not mean 91% of the people of the workforce are okay. You know, 9% is the unemployment rate. There's an underemployment rate of around 17%. If you capture how many people are not only unemployed or underemployed on average each month, but at some point during the year, which is much higher, it's roughly double that. So there's roughly a third of the workforce that's going to be unemployed or underemployed at some point during the year. If you look in polls, respondents tell you that in last June, 42% of people said they were unemployed or a member of their family was unemployed. Because we're looking at family income here, which is shared, right? So that's 42%. There's another 38%, which overlaps, which they or someone in their family experienced an hours reduction, a wage reduction, or a major benefit reduction, right? So there's a lot of people really getting hammered, so to speak. So in some ways, it's surprising to see so little. If you look at... I looked up the numbers on long-term unemployment. Compared to 2007, in 2011, there's roughly 5 million more people each month who have been unemployed at least 6 months. And there's roughly 4 million, 3.8 to 4 million each month that have been unemployed more than a year. So that's a big increase over that period of time. And it's not all 1 year change like this, but... So in some ways, we've experienced something really awful, and the index, has gone up, but it's not gone up remarkably. It has not gone up as much as I might have expected. And I'm going to just make a few data nerdy points now. One is, in the description of the increase in insecurity, it's not so great to just look at the endpoints. If you want to estimate a trend, you would want to estimate a trend with unemployment rates or something like that, not the 1986 versus now when we're in a trough. Usually economists compare trough to trough, peak to peak, things like that. I'm sure it's going up, and it's going up a lot, remarkably, within each business cycle, which is useful to say. Again, I'd love to have the actual numbers in the tables and or graphs. I find the selection of years to be odd. They happen to be like the first 10 years, the second 10 years, and what's left over. But, we economists like to look at, cyclical peaks or business cycles. So the years you have, 1986 to 1995, I go like, what's that? It's the first 10 years of the data you have. I get it. But the last thing I'll say is there's a lot of discussion of disparity of economic insecurity, and I think that's really important. I think it's important not to focus on the levels as much, who's got the highest, but how they've changed. So, for instance, it's less interesting. It's interesting that college graduates have less insecurity than high school grads, but it's equally or more interesting to me that the level of insecurity increased about as much for every educational group. Table figure 7, especially if you throw out the two brackets, which only have around 10% of the workforce, less than high school and more than college. Those are kind of outliers, but everybody else, and you can actually see, I think the some college people actually increased, their insecurity increased more than high school. And it's also useful to know that if you look at people with a college degree in the recession, their economic insecurity is higher than what high school grads' insecurity was before the recession, and much higher than what high school grads had in your first 10 years. So, this is really an equal opportunity mess we're in, and people of all educational groups have experienced a lot of damage. And thank you very much, and congratulations on this great report. The Rockefeller Institute should respond by starting an initiative to protect workers in the downturn and to explore worker economic insecurity.
Inside joke.
That's a joke. very inside joke.
Yeah.
Sounds like a funding application.
No. They closed down their program for their initiative on worker economic insecurity earlier this year in the midst of the worst downturn in 80 years.
I also want to start by thanking Jacob for doing this report and actually for his work over the years. You know, when I was initially working on healthcare reform when I was a little past 18, I was flailing about for a while trying to figure out how to put all these pieces together, and actually Jacob played no small role with his work, both statistical and on the history of the American welfare system, in giving me an analytical framework that I could then tell a story about how American healthcare had changed, not just in the last 10, 20 years, but in the last 100 years. So I'm very grateful for that. I'm grateful for this report, which I think will, I hope, will get a lot of attention. Larry is a lot nerdier than I am, and I mean that in the best sense possible as a policy wonk who aspires to nerddom. So I'm not going to try to be so nerdy. I'm going to instead come at this as someone who thinks like a journalist. And as a journalist, you know, I'm always primarily concerned with the WGS factor, which is the who gives a something. And after all, I mean, it's not as if you need a lovely produced and foundation-backed, extensively peer-reviewed report to tell us that, you know, there's a lot of people struggling right now. It's hard when you struggle. It's not a good thing, and we should do something about it. Reports like this actually have an important piece in our political ecosystem. I think sometimes those of us who live, read, and breathe these numbers sometimes forget that. But the fact is, a report like this, you know, it will get headlines. It will generate news attention. And as somebody who makes a point every morning of turning on I live in Ann Arbor, Michigan, so I turn on the Detroit local radio station every morning. And I always listen to the one line I'm going to get on the AM radio about some news development in the business cycle. And, you know, things like this, they make, you know, you'll hear that one line and it'll get repeated. And on the nightly news, it'll be a segment. And this will drive coverage. Reports like this drive coverage. They play a very important role. And it's important that these things be rigorous. And I think you're to be complimented on trying to do something that wasn't, you know, I've seen a lot of these reports. Not all of them have such distinguished committees looking over them. Not all of them go to such lengths to be rigorous about the data. And that's not to say it's a perfect statistical measure you've produced here. I think anybody who has spent any time with these measures will agree that there is no perfect measure of economic security. Larry has raised some interesting points. Why is this not bigger? Why are we not seeing larger numbers here in the middle of this vast economic downturn? You mentioned another one during your presentation. If you're trying to capture the impact that medical expenses has on incomes, and your measure is a delta, it's a change from year to year, you're going to miss a lot of people with chronic disease. And again, anybody who knows healthcare will tell you that's where a lot of the big spending is. That's where a lot of the big hit is. So, you know, this is not a perfect measure, but it's a measure. And I think we look to these measures, we put them all together, and it builds a case that builds a case for media coverage, it builds a case for political action. And, you know, sometimes we find interesting things when we look at these numbers. I was very struck by figure 2. Let me find it here in the report. Maybe I wasn't the only one, which had the regional differences of which parts of the country had the larger changes. And where is it? It's
the beginning.
Very beginning. Page 5. Thank you. Page 5. And we see that the North Central and Northeast were slightly more economically secure by this index than the South and the West. Now, being from Michigan, we don't often get to say that we're, you know, in the vanguard of economic security, so this obviously played to my regional pride. But that's a very interesting phenomenon. I would be interesting to know, is this a reflection of the economy, the nature of the economy? Is it a reflection of government programs, union density? Or is it, again, because you're measuring the change here as opposed to the static picture? Is this simply the fact that, hey, we in Michigan, we've been enjoying a recession for 20 years. We're just excited the rest of you all caught up to us. On the question of the picture you showed before on medical expenses by income and by age group, You could read that, as you said, one of two ways. One story you could tell is that, well, here we have the parts of the population where we've intervened most aggressively in the last 10, 20 years, low-income groups, and we see that they are more protected, it appears, against medical expenses. Is that because we've done a better job, or is that because they're still having such a hard time, they're just postponing health care? Or is it both? That's not something you can answer with this report, but you know, this is an interesting avenue for somebody else to explore, and I hope we will. But I think the third point, and this was the one that really struck me, and it was the first graph you showed, and it appears twice in your report, is figure one, and then again, I think figure three, which is the long-term upward trend in economic insecurity. And if you look at the numbers, and if I'm reading this graph right, what's really remarkable here is that the figure for 2006, the percentage, is actually higher or roughly the same height as it is at the peak of the previous recession. So this is, we were already had economic insecurity equal to the previous recession before the new recession even began. That's a pretty remarkable statistic. Now, again, I'm not nerdy enough to sit here and tell you whether that statistic is absolutely correct, whether it's missing something. But you know, this story of rising economic insecurity as a long-term trend and not a short-term trend, that certainly rings true to me. It's consistent with everything else I've seen. And I think it's very important as we enter this political season. Obviously, the focus is going to be on the economy. How do we get jobs? How do we rescue people from this downturn? But there's a longer story here. And when we talk about the other 99%, we talk about long-term strategies for trying to bring the federal budget under control with the combinations of taxes and expenditures. I think it's important to remember that something's been going on for a very long time in this country, something that's been eroding at the basic fundamental idea of economic security that once upon a time most people in this country enjoyed. And simply creating more jobs and getting the economy on a sound footing isn't necessarily going to take care of that problem. So there you go. And turn over to my friend Matt here.
All right. Well, I'm so glad to be here this afternoon, and I want to thank Jacob for having me. You know, this is always really like one of the key people I point to when I try to persuade people that like ideas really do make a difference in the long term in the political realm, and that you know things aren't just about elections and power. And I think we've seen that over and over again in his career. But with that in mind, I did want to share a couple of points of puzzlement on my part as to what it is we're really seeing in the long-term trend here. That you know, a lot of the time when we look at the economy, we're looking at very large sort of macro aggregates. Did household income go up or did it go down? And of course, it's a big country, hundreds of millions of people, you know, very many households. So those broad aggregates, you know, mask an enormous variety in individual stories that you're seeing. So in any given time, some people are doing much worse than the average, and others are perhaps doing better. You know, one reason you might see just an increase in the number of people suffering very large losses is that if the overall growth rate slows down, then, you know, that's going to mean that more people get sort of pushed below that 25% threshold. But I'm not sure we would really want to describe that as an increase in insecurity. I mean, it is an increase in insecurity, but if the increase in insecurity is simply being driven by a slowdown in the overall rate of income growth, that to me is a different story from a story if just hard luck cases are getting even less lucky than they used to be. It has different policy implications, among other things. Is this really a question of do we need to strengthen our buffers against severe deprivation, or is it a question of we need to look at, you know, why is it that overall wages for people who are doing okay have tended to slow down? Because as he noted in his presentation, this has actually been a period of time in which we seem to have acted, at least on the medical front, to do a lot to bolster the sort of unluckiest cases, to expand Medicaid, to expand SCHIP. During the recession, we've expanded unemployment insurance. So, you know, we're doing things at those kind of severe bad outcomes. The other thing that's just amazing looking at this chart is the financial wealth one that pulled up on the screen. You have here, page 13, figure 5. you know, it's really striking that the median household has managed to accumulate absolutely no non-housing wealth on net, basically ever in the course of this time period. That, you know, if you look at the survey results that we started this with, people claim to be extremely concerned about volatility and security in this particular way, that they say, you know, that they care more about the prospect of losing out than about the opportunity to get ahead. You know, the natural thing you would expect households to do if that's really their priority is to start stocking up substantial financial buffers. If you're a very loss-averse person, you know, that's what you're going to do. In practice, we have not seen that. Americans have a very low household savings rate compared to what you see in many foreign countries. You know, and that includes countries where the median income is a lot lower than it is in the United States. Nonetheless, people are setting more aside for various kinds of reasons. Obviously, we had, particularly during the most recent expansionary period, there was a lot of encouragement, both official and sort of unofficial encouragement, for people to think of their home, their owner-occupied housing, as a great savings vehicle, even though it's in fact not a savings vehicle. It's a net liability if the price of your house goes down, as everybody has discovered. So, you know, I mean, simply in a qualitative sense, this strikes me as the thing where there's the most obvious focus. There's a disconnect between what it is people are actually doing with their money and with their financial decision making and what they say their priorities are. And I suspect that disconnect isn't simply that suddenly everyone became, you know, very stupid and doesn't know that you can save money. It's rather that, you know, we've had various different things going on that have encouraged people to make certain kinds of choices that obviously have not panned out well, and that, you know, we need to think about facilitating, encouraging ways for people to actually put aside money in a meaningful way, or to return to the kind of defined benefit programs that used to provide more automaticity to those things. That there was a big concept of a quote-unquote ownership society, but that what we had in practice is obviously a debt society, and that leaves people much, much more vulnerable to income loss. And we saw in the chart that, you know, the wealth cushion does not undo these effects, but it makes a big difference. I mean, if people are able to save in a realistic way, that can help them with a lot of these problems, and that's what saving is for, but we don't have nearly enough of it. So I guess that's what I've got.
That's great.
Thank you. I think first I want to give Jacob a chance to reply to some of these comments. Larry's peak-to-peak, trough-to-trough. I looked at some of your dates, and I was thinking, well, those look like important years for the Boston Red Sox. 86 came to mind. But you can explain. That's probably not the rationale. But if you could deal with some of Larry's points. I, too, was struck, as Jonathan was, by how well the Midwest and the Northeast were doing in these numbers. Is that really the been down so long it looks like up to me phenomenon, or what's going on there? And Matt's point about savings and the fact that we were a debt society and the difficulty that in order to hold up their standard of living, people have had to resort to borrowing because they couldn't increase their incomes anymore. If you could deal with those three questions, and then we can move on from there. And any other comments you want to make in
sure.
response to
Well,
these?
I want to keep it brief because I really would like to open it up. So let me take up the savings question first. All I can say is that when we've looked across countries, we've found a similar relationship. That is, countries with more unstable income seem to have lower savings rates. Either this is the limits of individual rationality, it could be something about the coincidence of instability and other factors that depress savings rate. But it seems as if people who are experiencing, and it's certainly at the individual level, that's the case as well, that the groups that are subject to the highest levels of insecurity have the lowest savings rate, but there's lots of obvious confounding factors. So I think it's really worth examining more. Austin has done a little bit of analysis of retirement savings and volatility, and if I fair to sum it up as saying volatility doesn't seem to have much effect one way or the other on retirement savings, so which is itself puzzling in both directions. What I will say is that I think your other point about the Our savings, our financial wealth measure does not include holdings in defined contribution plans. And so there has been a big shift over time from defined benefit plans, which don't show up on balance sheets, and defined contribution plans that do show up on household balance sheets.
Please correct. These probably do reflect defined contribution, but not defined benefit.
We exclude both.
You exclude both. Okay.
Yes. Well, defined benefit will not be there, obviously.
Okay.
So we exclude both, but we also include both withdrawals from both at retirement. So, but the point is only that shift. There's a question there about whether or not households that are holding retirement assets in defined contribution plans, whether they see them in part as a substitute for other forms of savings. You can, after all, borrow against a 401k plan. You get it as a lump sum when you change jobs, and lots of people spend that lump sum rather than saving it. I would also say that there is this big elephant in the room, which is house price values were going up during this period. And so the real test for the theory, right, is going forward. But my sense is that you need that what's needed to encourage savings is both cultural and in terms of policy, and that clearly it wasn't in place in the United States over this period. I would just caution to say that I don't think with a lot of these large-scale dislocations that savings alone is only a partial, small but important part of the response. When we did the last report, we did not have actual data for for the post-2007 period, so we projected forward, and the number we got was essentially the same as what we're ending up with here. However, it's worth noting that the levels were in general slightly lower in the survey of income and program participation. And so in that sense, we were surprised in that we would have expected it to be slightly higher. I would note part of the answer, which we're going to be exploring, is that it could be public policy. Part of it is this important point about the nature of the index, which it captures instability in income. So it will certainly pick up the initial increase in unemployment, but it depending on how that's timed and how it's shared within households, it might be smaller than you would think. Lastly, I would just say, and so this is something that we'd like to explore more. Lastly, I would say is that I think we worked very hard in general to make sure that the measure was, I wouldn't say as conservative as possible, but that it was really capturing very clear and easily identified losses of this sort. I think that there's certainly a lot more that goes along with unemployment and long-term unemployment than what we're picking up with this measure. And any time that you are also being very careful with data, what you tend to do is, in my experience, is you tend to depress trends over time. So that it's possible that we're one to be even less vigilant with regard to misclassifying people as insecure, that you might get a slightly different trend. So I will only mention one quick thing that John brought up, and then one quick thing that Matt brought up really quickly. We did a series of regressions when we were doing the projections, and it's worth noting that overall growth did not seem very highly correlated with our measure. We also did a bunch of regressions that had time trends in them and controlled for unemployment, and needless to say that the upward trend is statistically significant even when you control for these other factors. Why did we start in 1986? There's two reasons. One, our prior report based on when the SIP begins had to start in 85, so we thought there was symmetry there and that we would eventually go back to earlier years. It's actually very hard to do the earlier years with the March CPS, and we can't do the medical spending and the debt side of things for earlier years. But there's another reason, which is in 85 is one of those data void years in the March CPS. You actually can't get 85, so we can't get 95 as well, and we just interpolate between those 94 and 96. So there was sort of another justification for starting there. There was no other reason than that, and I guess that's not a reason that would seem any less arbitrary than the ones you offered, but that is the reason. So John just asked about what would, a very good question from a medical care expert, which would, I think, implicit is sort of what would be the right measure of medical care risk. And I think it would ultimately have to be some measure that combined actual spending and what spending, in some sense should have been. And one way you could do that was look at similarly situated people, right, who have similar, but you'd have to get health status variables to really do that. So The problem is really, you know, spending is highly variable, even among people who are diagnosed with the same conditions. But I think that would be the way to go. You would know that someone is massively underspending if they have a condition that is very costly and report a condition that's very costly, but they report very little in the way of medical spending.
Thank you very much. I want to get to the audience right away, so I'm going to ask a question which I want to have in the backgrounds as, for you as you answer the audience question. My bias, both as a newspaper columnist and as a Brookings person, is what good is a report if it doesn't have policy implications? So I'd like each of you, as you're answering other questions, to be thinking about what one might, what sense one might make of this in policy terms. And here at New America, they give you some very helpful hints on moderating up here. It says, remind the audience we are filming and everything is on the record. Remind questioners to wait for the microphone. That good gentleman back there has it. Identify yourself and keep their questions concise. And then it's a pep talk. It says, be a firm moderator. Don't be shy about urging a questioner or a presenter to get to their point or get back to topic. So I'll just say that off. That's only what it tells me here. So that gentleman is right next to you. Let's start there. Maybe we can collect a couple at a time so we can get more people in. Sir.
All right, I'm Arnold Packer. We always see in journals such as The Economist the benefits of flexible labor force and the problems that come about with rigid labor force policies in places like Spain and elsewhere. Does this suggest that there would be more happiness if our labor force was more rigid?
Larry, why don't you take that one?
I thought you were going to accumulate.
Oh, yeah, that's, yeah, please. Oh, go ahead. You go to this person right here.
On that same vein, I haven't heard any, my name is Greg Whithead, formerly with the AFL-CIO, now retired. I haven't heard any explanation about union density, either in figure three, the long-term trend, and in the regional explanation.
And then that lady back there, I think, yeah.
Hi, I'm Shannon Brownlee. I'm the acting director of the health policy program here at New America. I have a question and a comment. The comment is that embedded in your statistics is the fact that average wages have been stagnant in large measure because of rising healthcare spending and healthcare costs, which come out of workers' wages, particularly low-end workers' wages. The question is, can you parse your data by zip code? Because I think you would see some very interesting regional differences if you were to look at it on the basis of hospital referral regions, where my other hat is at Dartmouth. And what we've seen is that healthcare spending is rising very, very rapidly in some parts of the country and really not rising rapidly at all in other parts of the country. And I wonder if you would see that economic insecurity embedded in your statistics if you were able to pull it out by zip code.
Larry, you want to start since I already invited you to?
Yeah. Well, I want to just, on the last question, I think this is a new myth about healthcare being the reason for stagnant wages. I don't believe it whatsoever. I understand that there's something to it, but low-wage workers, very few actually get employer-provided health coverage, and their wage trends are as bad as everybody else's. You can also look at any particular period of time when healthcare costs are going up or down. It's not necessarily the times when you're going to have poor wage growth. So I think this is, I mean, there is some trade-off, but to elevate it to a macro explainer of wage stagnation, I think is not right. But I'll leave the rest of the questions of that to other people. I like Arnie's question about flexibility. Well, I mean, it means it's flexible. If you have a flexible labor market, meaning you can easily get screwed, but no one helps you to soften the blow, that's a bad problem. But if you had a flexible labor market in Denmark, but people helped you to get by, then you wouldn't find this. So it's not so much as flexibility as much as it is the whole system. Union density. Greg's question. I'm not sure. I mean, other than I'm not sure how the as a big believer in the importance of unions. I'm not sure how that connects, actually.
A 20-year contract, you have that period of time with relative security.
Right.
Unless you got laid off.
Yeah, or unless you, and there's not that many. I don't think this has a lot to do with people who are in continued employment taking a very large-scale wage cut, which can happen with a union contract or not. But I'm not so sure this is one phenomena that that relates to that.
Who wants to go?
I can just say a couple quick things. Because we have looked in the panel study of income dynamics of individual level correlates, controlling for other factors of volatility, and union membership does seem to lower income instability. The problem is that holding other factors constant is very difficult, and this is sort of what the peril of a lot of the comparisons, a lot of the naive comparisons of wages or benefits across union and non-union workplaces. But I would guess there is an effect there, and the fact that unions are a smaller share of the workforce is part, but not a big part, but part of the story. I haven't looked across the regional dimension, but I think that'd be worth examining. In general, I just want to note that one of the you say benefits or drawbacks of our measure is it's completely naive to compositional changes in the workforce or the society, right? So people have gotten older, but then there's more minorities in the population. It's a picture of American instability as it actually has changed. When you start to look within demographic groups, as Larry was saying, you find that groups have very different levels, but that there's been an increase almost across the board, which I think is a notable fact and fits well with the kind of conception of what's happened to our economy that focuses on trends that affected a fairly large share of the population, not just those at the very bottom. And on Shannon's question, I would only say, clearly is the case that total compensation has risen more than cash wages. It's also the case that when you look at the Congressional Budget Office data, for example, which tries to include employment-based health benefits, that there's still very modest growth at the middle. So as Larry was saying, perhaps more strongly than I would, it doesn't obviously undo the conclusion that there's been a slow growth in total income, total compensation, including health benefits. We did a test just to see if this had any effect on our index, because you might think that as people we're counting medical costs, but we're not taking into account whether you get employment-based health insurance, and that's a form of compensation. And so we did check this, and it doesn't. If anything, we're probably once again biasing toward finding greater stability, because actually there's been a decline in the average likelihood of getting insurance at your place of work. And so if anything, it's essentially our ignoring it is making us see people as slightly more secure than they would otherwise be.
Jonathan, you have a view on the health
care. Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, I think it's both things can be true, though, right? I mean, it can be absolutely the case, what Shannon, I mean, you're measuring medical costs both. I mean, you would see it mass. You would presumably see some impact of higher health insurance premiums in the income figures. Plus, there's the higher out-of-pocket costs that you've observed. I mean, there were some large figures there.
Can I just say something there, John? Because I think this is actually an area of research that's needed, which is that when we went back and looked at some other data sources on the 70s, what we found is that uninsured people had much higher out-of-pocket medical costs than insured people. In recent decade, in like the last 15 years or so, we find, generally speaking, that people who have insurance are spending more, especially if you're including employer-provided premiums, which suggests that those who are uninsured are either getting charity care or not getting care, which is sort of the point that we were talking about earlier. So it's something that really requires more investigation.
Right. I mean, I was going to say, I mean, I think, you know, how you can break this down in the data, this data is very hard to break down. I mean, we run into this every time we try to break that down, and I have no idea whether it would show up in the zip code data or not, although the zip code data about hospital referrals is very real. That part I know is true. But I think there's some trade-off. I mean, whether it's the big macro explanation, I mean, I just think it's important to establish there is some trade-off. I think most people agree with that.
I agree.
And the fact that you would have, it could be an explanation for what's happening at more upper income levels, I would think, and not at lower income levels is plausible, to me at least, I mean.
This lady in the front row, I'm sorry, I'm making you run around.
Thank you. Ramsey Alwyn with the National Council on Aging. I have two questions. The first is about disaggregating and cross-tabulation, looking at race, gender, and age, and if there are plans to do some analysis on that front. And the second is, there was a figure shared in the presentation in terms of different thresholds of hardship and how long it takes one to recover. And as I recall, the figure showed up on average it was about 7 years, regardless of the threshold. And I was just wondering what the assumptions were around that recovery for an individual.
So another person want to get in it? Right in front there. I love Washington think tank audiences disaggregating cross-tabulation thresholds of high-end crowd.
I'm Mitzi Wertheim with the Naval Postgraduate School. I'm going to ask a slightly different question. We live in a society where it's all based on continuous growth and continuous consumption. How does this fit into the kinds of things you're talking about from a policy standpoint?
Do you want to start with the question about...
So on the disaggregation, I really encourage you to take a look at the web tool. You can actually do up to 4 cross tabs. I think generally speaking, you get up to 3 and you start to run into small N problems. We won't let you see the data if it's fewer than, I think, 50 respondents who represent that group. So if you try to do single mothers who are 18 to 34 and who have less than a college education, and then you try to add one more on, like race, then it usually says you can't go there. But you can look very closely at these different crosstabs. And if you take a look at the site, you'll see that the y-axis is very high. It's about 40%.
Which means that
I'm going to explain. So it means that there are some groups for which we had to put the axis up that high because they reach up to levels that are close to 30 to 40% chance of this kind of large experience of this large income loss. On this, your second part of your question, Austin's actually here, and he's the expert on these recovery paths. That was illustrative, but what we do, what we're doing is we're looking at, for people who experience losses of these 3 different sizes that I put up there, what is the typical recovery path? That is, what's the median recovery path? That's half of people recover more quickly and half of people recover more slowly. And it turns out that it takes a while for people to recover. At 4 to 6 years, is that correct? So 4 to 6 years is the typical recovery path. It's slightly different than those numbers I put up because those are naive just looking at the actual data, whereas we do a statistical modeling that takes into account the fact that our data is censored and other...
Do you look at different demographics?
Because we wanted to have a large enough N to be able to reliably estimate that, we basically looked at people by drop size, by family income prior to the drop, and by age. So it doesn't look at race. So actually, in that sense, we're kind of probably giving an extra. We're lowering the threshold for some very disadvantaged groups because they almost certainly will have a longer recovery path. But as it turns out, it just really most people don't have enough savings to be able to offset these kind of income declines. On the second part about continuous growth, my view on this is that while growth has a huge role in thinking about our long-term economic well-being, that this measure of income stability is to some extent a little orthogonal to growth, and this is sort of speaks to Matt's question as well. Because we found across countries that rates of growth don't seem to be strongly correlated with income instability, it's not the case that you, and this may speak to the flexible labor markets question as well, it's not the case that there seems to be a huge sort of growth instability trade-off. And one of the things that I think is most interesting in these results is I was concerned when we started doing this work that these downward drops were just the flip side of upward mobility, that people had a big jump in 1 year and then fell back. But when you look across countries, you could sort of draw a diagonal line looking at increases and decreases, right? And if there's the same number of people experiencing 25% increases as experiencing 25% losses, then the country would be right on the diagonal. Most of the countries are up here, right? So they have more increases than decreases. The United States is right on the diagonal. So over this period, at least, it doesn't look like there's been a big upside gain for these downside losses.
Matt, I can't resist throwing the big think future of growth question to you.
I wanted to say on consumption, something that's interesting, that if you look at, you know, all the different variants of this stability line, it's very jagged. You know, things are very different one year to the next. You can see a long-term trend. I was looking recently at the longer-term trend in personal consumption, and that is much, much, much smoother. You know, one way or another, people through most of this period are finding ways to sort of juggle, using whatever, credit cards, housing wealth, so on and so forth. And then what you see in the recession is a huge and really unprecedented collapse in personal consumption, which I think you can infer is sort of like the time when all the tricks ran out. You know, there was sort of nothing more to get at. And that, I mean, in some ways shows the realest, sharpest point of instability in people's lives, when you have no more way of getting stuff. People have a lot of ways of compensating for income loss historically, and they really just don't anymore.
Which raises interesting questions about the future of growth. Given this experience, will people go back to if they ever have the opportunity again, to the mix of borrowing, converting this or that, or will we be operating at a lower level of consumption for a while?
Yeah, and there was a report out today from the New York Fed showing much lower levels of debt than had existed even a quarter ago. And I called them up and I asked, you know, well, is this actually, are people paying their debts off or are people going bankrupt? And they said, well, you know, in a couple months we'll have that.
Last round of questions. Please, sir. And then way in the back.
My name is Robert Hurstein. I just am speculating whether the increase in U.S. population due to immigration during the period you are covering might consist heavily of people who enter the workforce at a very vulnerable level, and whether that might in turn account for the increase in your blue line on income vulnerability.
That's a great question. I'd be curious what kind of, how you cut your data on that. And then, yes, ma'am.
My name is Li Yang. I appreciate this effort about all this income stability or how to help the homelessness or poor or lower income. But problem is my major concern is really that data, the reliability of this data that you use to really measure the reliability of this situation. And the effort you want to do is whether the nonprofit organization or government policies, they really put some effort and resources to resolve the problem. Because a lot of times, whether the money go to education or go to health, human services, those money resources are not really benefit the targeted population, rather than those money or even people's resources have been deprived of by those people who benefit themselves rather than benefit our society or poor income. So I wonder if you have this kind of effort or, you know, any kind of study try to resolve this type of problem.
Could I just, on that question, read a sentence out of the, a couple of sentences out of the report, which I think are partly responsive, because I appreciate the fact that you pointed out that, and I'm quoting here, for many Americans, especially the poorest or those who have the fewest financial resources, the 25% threshold of loss may be too high. About 1 in 5 Americans, according to the survey conducted in conjunction with the study, indicate that they would face financial hardship if they were forced to go for as little as 2 weeks without income. So I think it does address part of that, but we'll close taking those two questions. Larry?
Well, I'll save Jacob some time and try to respond to the immigration one a little bit. I'm sure this is not a complete answer, but if you look at figure 10, which has Hispanics, non-Hispanic whites, Hispanics, non-Hispanic blacks, you'll see that there's not much of an increase in economic insecurity in the first two periods among Hispanics, and there was a lot of growth of immigration in that period. So it seems like immigration wouldn't be driving it. And in fact, if you look over the entire beginning to end periods, It might be that actually non-Hispanic whites have the largest increase in economic insecurity. So that would be the group that probably has the least growth of immigration. So it wouldn't seem like immigration is driving this, is what I would deduce.
I mean, that would have been my answer, Larry.
I'm just trying to save
so
you
thank
time.
You very much. I only add that there might be indirect effects of immigration that wouldn't be captured here on the labor market. There might be indirect effects of immigration on the labor market, but my read of the economics literature on this is that that it's probably not, those are probably not that large compared with other factors that are going on here. So I would just speak for a second to your point in the second question, which is to say that I think that one of the drawbacks of any index that is based on existing data, like the Census Bureau data, is that as comprehensive as it is, it doesn't include a lot of the questions you'd certainly be interested in right now about how people have actually coped with these economic losses. So we did ask such questions in our own survey. And I would just note as another sort of plug for the levels for what it's worth, we don't have a comparative survey from earlier periods, that when we calculated the annual income loss, we asked people whether they had a 25% or greater income loss, and we got 19.4%, which is essentially exactly what we got for the income loss component of our index for the same year. So I don't know what the comparison is in the past, obviously, but it, again, was remarkably close. We asked about unmet needs, which I think are close to the consumption discussion earlier. We asked about whether people had gone without food or medical care because of the cost, or whether they'd had difficulty paying their bills, and questions of that sort. And it was striking that people who'd experienced various shocks as we measured them, such as losing a job or having very high medical costs, were much, much more likely to have those kind of unmet needs. And even that was true even among middle-class families. I think that's, while Matt is certainly right that aggregate consumption trends have been pretty stable, there's some evidence that, and it's still a debate, is that it looks like consumption volatility has increased during this period. But I think he hits it exactly right in sort of implicitly quoting that old aphorism attributed to the economist Herb Stein, known as Stein's Law, that if something can't go on forever, it won't. And that, you know, borrowing, like people were borrowing, especially against homes that were overvalued, sending a second earner into the workforce, and the like, these were strategies that had inherent limits, and now we're sort of facing up to that, those limits today. But I would say, in closing, just to sort of thank everyone I want to thank everyone for being here, and say that Larry, in particular, I'm going to take all your comments to heart, and there will be a new version of the report at some point that will have more justifications and nicer graphs. And the state of working America has set a high standard that we all should aspire to.
Thank you all very, very much.